Blackstone Audiobooks presents
Jefferson and His Time, Volume 2, Jefferson and the Rights of Man, by Dumas Malone. Introduction. This book, which is a unit in itself, is the second volume in the series I'm writing under the general title Jefferson and His Time, and a sequel to Jefferson the Virginian, 1743 to 1784. That volume carried the story through the American Revolution and ended with Jefferson's departure for France. The present one, 1784 to 1792, includes his European mission, which lasted through the opening months of the French Revolution, and all but the final year of his service in his own country as the first Secretary of State under the new Constitution. In the perspective of history, the winning of American independence was a cosmic event. And Jefferson, during the period of his life that we have already described, proclaimed and sought to implement a philosophy which he regarded as timeless and universal. But the setting of the previous volume was chiefly local. To me, the Virginia of his youth and early manhood will ever be a charming scene. But Paris and Versailles in the time of Louis XVI, London in the reign of George III, and New York and Philadelphia in the presidency of George Washington provided a far richer and more colorful background than Monticello and Williamsburg. And Jefferson participated in far more complicated movements and events in this second period of his public life than in his first. Furthermore, as the bibliography shows more specifically, the materials for these years, while sometimes disappointing, are in general so extensive as to be positively embarrassing. The complexity of the events and the vastness of the materials provide a sufficient explanation, I hope, for my inability to carry this volume as far in point of time as I formerly expected and indiscreetly predicted. When I wrote the introduction to the earlier book, assuming that four volumes would be all the publishers or public could be expected to stand for, I was planning to carry Jefferson to the presidency in the second. It became obvious, however, that this would be impossible if the scale of the first volume were maintained and the far more extensive materials were exploited to a comparable degree. Accordingly, with the generous concurrence of my publishers, I set out to find another logical terminal point. Washington's unanimous re-election to the presidency at the end of the year 1792 provides a good one. This is a convenient date in the domestic story, for a new chapter in the history of American political parties began thereafter. The period of 8.5 years that is covered in the present volume has biographical unity, since Jefferson was concerned primarily with foreign affairs throughout the whole of it. There was a marked change in the international situation early in the next year. Great Britain was then drawn into the European War, and Jefferson was faced with a new set of problems as Secretary of State. Some loose ends of diplomacy left dangling in the summer of 1792 will need to be tied up in the third volume of the series, but to all practical purposes it will start with the year 1793 and extend to the beginning of Jefferson's presidency in March 1801. That volume will trace the rise of political parties which existed in only rudimentary form in 1792, and it will be set on a background of world war and revolutionary violence, while the present one largely falls within a period of general peace and relatively philosophical revolution. It is unwise to make precise predictions in advance, but I see no reason why the presidency cannot be kept within the limits of a fourth volume. And the years of retirement, covered by a fifth, if the strength of the author and the patience of the publishers and the public will hold out that long. Throughout the months since I wrote the introduction to Jefferson the Virginian, I have kept in mind the purposes that I stated there for the work as a whole, namely that it be comprehensive and relate the man to his times and be true to his own chronology. A work of historical biography like this, predominantly narrative in form, does not lend itself to ready summary, but I will make a few observations in the light of these avowed purposes. The goal of comprehensiveness, that is, of showing the whole man and not...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.